You know, that video clip is only 18 seconds, but it's such a great visual representation or presentation of what we're talking about today, which is the galaxies, the stars, the constellations, the moons, the comets, and everything that you see up in the sky. And one of the joys of this series is that we get to engage with not only what God has created, but we get to engage with God himself through what he has created. And then we get to find ourselves somewhere in there. And there's joy in finding ourselves in that great story of God's creation. And my prayer this morning is that as we engage with the created things of God, we will look up and see him, but also see ourselves in the relationship that he wants to have with us and the relationship that he does have with us. So because what we're talking about today is so different from everything else, we have to put some groundwork. Because literally we're talking about things that are out of this world. But you know, before you go out of this world, you need to get your bearings right. You know, you need to be grounded. And for that, what we're going to do is we're going to start off with what the scientists tell us, right? So what we know, first we'll start with what God tells us, then we'll talk about what the scientists tell us, and then we'll mix it all up and see what we come up with. If I haven't said good morning, good morning. So, we know from Genesis 1 that God created the heavens and the earth, right? And the Bible puts it that simply. But this is what science over centuries is telling us about this earth that God created. The earth's diameter is 12,742 kilometers. So if you move from one end in a straight line to the other end of the earth, it's 12,000. This is going to get mind-bending. The weight of the earth, if you were to weigh the earth on a scale, I know we're Zimbabweans and we're used to these numbers, but this one, this one. The weight of the earth is 6 septillion kilograms. I'll help you. It's 6 with 24 zeros. That's the weight of the earth. And the scientists are telling us this through mathematical calculations, gravitational calculations, and all sorts of things. Let's look at the moon, because the moon was also created. The moon is about the quarter of the size of the earth, but it is not a planet, it's a moon. They call it a celestial body with no atmosphere. So it's different from a star, different from a planet in some ways. And then the sun. The sun is 1.3 million kilometers across. So if you were to put a tape measure from one end of the sun to the other, it would be 1.3 million kilometers. If you put it in meters, you add another 3 zeros, that becomes a billion meters or something. And how many Earths can fit in the sun? About 1,300. And the sun is different from the Earth and the moon because it's a star, and a star, it's just a ball of fire. It's full of hot plasma, gases. And the reason why it keeps burning like that is because there's nuclear explosions happening every second. And it is so hot and so powerful that it's bright and we can see it from a distance. Now, when we look at the moon and the star and the sun, sometimes we might think they're the same size, but they're not. It is simply because the sun is so far away that to us it almost looks like the size of the moon. And yet God says in Genesis 1, God made two great lights. the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night, which is the moon. And he didn't hear this. He says, he also made the stars. Stars. And yet we know that stars, the star that is closest to us is the sun. And you know how far it is. Like I said, it is 93 million miles away, which is about 150 million kilometers away. And because the astronomers are like Zimbabweans, they don't like the zeros, they chop them off. So they use the distance between the Earth and the sun, and they call that an astronomical unit. So you then don't have to say every time, so for every 150 million kilometers, you simply say one astronomical unit, chop off the zeros, and we can start again. That's how big the sun is. And we have not even left our own galaxy. A galaxy is a cluster of stars. They estimate that each galaxy has got about 100 to 200 billion stars and planets and all of these things. Our own is called the Milky Way because it just looks like a band of spilt milk. But that's because it's got so many stars and they're shining towards each other that it, to us, it just looks like a band of milk. And how many stars are in there? Planets? 200 billion plus. And how many galaxies are there? They estimate that there are between 200 billion galaxies. Remember I said each galaxy has got 200 billion stars and planets. There are 200 billion galaxies. And all these numbers, they're mind-blowing. I'm sure right now you don't even remember any of the numbers that I've mentioned. All of that is in there. And maybe at some point, we need to accept that the galaxies are immeasurable. That actually maybe we can't count the stars. As much as the scientists will tell us that they can, really, whether you call it an astronomical calculation, what it is a guess. Because you're looking at only one corner of the galaxy. And then saying, right, if there's about 200 billion here, then I multiply that's close to 2 trillion. We can't count the number of stars. So if this is what the galaxy is, this is all creation from God, what about God himself? This is what he says. In Psalm 147, 4-5, he says, it says, he counts the stars. Remember, you and me can't count them. But he says, he counts the stars. And more so, he gives names to all of them. He knows the 200 trillion stars and planets, and he knows each and every one of them by name. And he puts it this way to Isaiah chapter 40, verse 25 to 26. He says, to whom will you compare me? Who is my equal? Says the Holy One. Lift up your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all of these? He who brings out the starry host one by one and calls forth each of them by name because of his great power and mighty strength. And not one of them is missing. You might miss that. He says he counts the number of stars. He knows how many they are. He knows each of them by name. He gives them names. But he says not one of them is missing, which means that he can account for them. He can account for each one. If you were alive in 1986, I was, you saw something in the sky. Who was alive in 1986? What did you see? Halley's Comet. And you just stood there and you were like, wow. It's like this slow falling star with a tail. And God says, I know it. I know all comets like that. I know it by name, and I know where it is right now. Do you? Because he can account for each one. He knows where they are. And so when we can't count the stars, we have to admit that what is impossible for man is possible with God. That is how great God is. And just in case you're not convinced that God actually names the stars and he numbers them and he puts them there and his word sustains them, there's some constellations that are mentioned in the Bible specifically. When he is questioning Job in chapter 38, Job is in this difficult place of having lost everything. And God says to him, you stand up, be a man, answer my questions. And this is what he asks him about these three constellations. He says to Job in Job 38, can you bind the chains of the Pleiades? Can you loosen Orion's belt? Can you bring the bring forth the constellations in their seasons and lead out the bear with its cubs? I want you to notice two things here. One is that God has named or knows the names of these constellations, right? And number two, you will also notice that in case you're not convinced about the accuracy of the Bible, maybe this will. If you think, well, the Bible is just full of stories, let's look at it. There's an image I want to show you of the Pleiades. That's the Pleiades. So when you read Job, and the Bible says, can you bind the chains of the Pleiades? That's what he's talking about. So when the scientists have looked, you can see that it looks like there's chains, they are bound together. This is what the scientists have discovered. That the Pleiades are what they call a bound cluster. In other words, the gravitational forces between the stars are such that they can't move away as the universe expands. They are bound together. What does God say? Can you bind the Pleiades? Orion. God says, can you loosen Orion's belt? That's Orion. The little nebulous things that you see are gases and dust, but the stars are in there. There's a big star in the Orion Nebula that's called Betelgeuse. Just Google it. It's bigger than the sun. It's in there. And God says, can you loosen Orion's belt? Here's what the scientists tell us. That actually the gravitational system of this nebula is so unstable that actually it is falling apart. What does God say? He has loosened Orion's belt. Can you bring forth the constellations in their seasons or lead out the bear? This is the bear. So a constellation is a system of stars that when we look at it from Earth, we can draw patterns around it as we imagine it. So if you look, you can say, oh, that looks like a cross. This one looks like a bear. This is the bears that God is talking about. All of these are not only created by God, they are known by God. They are accounted for by God. And these are things that show his absolute greatness. So when we look at these stars and we consider their distance and we consider their weight and we consider their brightness, we have to think, there must have been a reason for God to have done this. There must be a purpose. I mean, there must be a reason. And God says it right at the beginning, and I want us to look at this in two ways. One is that there's a functional purpose, like a usefulness to having stars up in there, right? Which even atheists will accept, right? So when you read Genesis 1, for instance, it says that he created them to serve as signs to mark sacred times, days, and years. So we already know that these stars, the way they move, we can use them to mark sacred times and days and years. And just to earth that, a day simply means the amount of time that it takes for the earth to rotate on its own axis. That's 24 hours. That's a day. You count seven of those, that's a week, right? But when he says mark sacred times and days and years, what is God saying? God is saying, this is how you will know that today is the Sabbath. So there's a function, an order, a predictability in the stars that God wants us to use in order to then see them and worship him. This is how you are able to then tell the festivals. When he says it's Yom Kippur, they look up at the moon and the stars and say, yes, yes, it's a full moon. This is what we need to do in order to worship God. And if it's years, if it's the year of Jubilee, how will you have calculated the year of Jubilee? You need to have counted the years, isn't it? And get to that point and say, yes, this is the year of Jubilee when we free the slaves, when we forgive all debt. So God meant to have these, have a functional purpose. The second one is light. That's the easiest one. Let them be light in the vault of the sky to give light on earth. And don't we appreciate the moon on a dark night? So this all reveals God's power and divine nature. But there's another purpose. That purpose is that it is to reveal himself. When we read Romans 1 to 20, it says, for since creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power, divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. So creation points beyond itself. In the same way that you look at a beautiful picture and you wonder who the artist is, and you wonder what they might be like. So when we look at the stars, God is saying something of himself, and he's saying, come, search for me while I may be found. So the galaxies reveal his power and divine nature. But there's also a danger that God warns us about. And that danger is astrology. Because we can look at the stars and how they move and begin to think that perhaps the month that I was born, when this star was sitting over there and this constellation was over there, and therefore it means that my life is going to turn out this way. God says that is a form of divination, and he prohibits it. Oh, I'm Sagittarius, I'm a Virgo. You are now worshiping creation and not the creator. This is how he puts it in Deuteronomy. It says, and beware not to lift up your eyes to heaven and see the sun and the moon and the stars, all the host of heaven, and be drawn away and worship them and serve them, those which the Lord your God has allotted to all the peoples under the whole of heaven. So astrology is idolatry. What else do these galaxies reveal? They reveal his glory. This is how the psalmist in Psalm 19 puts it. He says, the heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. They have no speech. They use word, no sound, no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into all the earth. Their words to the ends of the world. God's galaxies are glorious in all their shapes, in all their size, in all their colors that we're able to see. But what about us? You get to the point where you accept, like, I think I'm nothing here. And this is the question that David grappled with in Psalm 8. He says, when I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings that you care for them. In all that power and glory, what is, why? Is it perhaps that God is just wanting to humble us, to remind us that we are mortal and nothing? As dust shall return to dust? Is it perhaps God just showing us his creative power, that he's so creative And he's joyful in doing it. Is it perhaps he wants to inspire us to worship him? But I think it's all of these and more. Because the one thing that we do know about God is that everything that he does, he is motivated by love. In Ephesians 1, he says in verse 4, "For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption into sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will." So here's the thing. If you can imagine how great God is, can you imagine how great his love is? When he calls himself, "I am Jehovah El Shaddai, the God Almighty who loves," how great is his love? How great is his love? How big is his heart? If he numbers the stars and yet again still says, "I have numbered you, your hairs. I know each one." Perhaps the galaxies are telling us that when we look up, we should be reminded of his great love. And that great love finds expression in a person. And that person is Jesus Christ. He is the one who comes to show us what Romans 8 says. Paul says, "I'm convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus." So when you consider the distance between us and the sun, one astronomical unit, and you think that you have sinned so far away, this God says, "Come to Christ. I am not that far away. I can come to you." And that's what he does in Jesus Christ. Way above heaven, immeasurable distances, he comes in the flesh as Jesus Christ. So let's let the size and magnitude of this universe inspire us to worship God. But also let's look at it as his demonstration of love. Let it point us to his love. And his love is a person. And you know, there are people who looked at the stars. They studied the stars, studied the galaxies and the movement of their movement, and they literally were led to Jesus Christ. Literally. Let's read together. Matthew 2. Verse 2, "After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, 'Where is the one who has been born king of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him.'" We jump to verse 9. "After they heard the king," because they had conversation with the king and the king wanted to find out the secrets in order to kill the king, it says, "They went on their way and the star they had seen when it rose ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed." Meaning, the stars pointed them to the King of the Jews that they were looking for. But here's what they are overjoyed when they find the star. Listen to this. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother, Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened the treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. So the galaxies are continually speaking to us, marking the times and the seasons, just like we're celebrating Christmas, the time of remembrance. The galaxies also reveal the power and divine nature of God. Galaxies also reveal his glory, his beauty, his creativity. But galaxies also point to Jesus Christ. So as you go kumusha and you kill a cow or a goat, or you're sitting by the fire at night and you look out into the galaxies, may that be a reminder. May that bring joy to you like it did for the Magi, that you may bow down and worship him. May we bow down and worship him and praise him. Him who considered equality with God to be nothing to hold on to, and he humbled himself and became a child. The galaxies point to Jesus Christ. Merry Christmas and amen.
Stars and whales.